What I'd like to do is ask if there are any past or present crew members of USS Constitution in the audience, or spouses of past or present crew members of Constitution in the audience. If you would please stand. I ask this because when we gather, we have a traditional toast. This one was penned by Commodore William Bainbridge in 1831. We consider this our loyal toast. And it goes like this. Never has she failed us. Never has her crew failed in showing their allegiance and belief in the country they served, or the honor they felt in belonging to the ship that sheltered them, and whose decks they fought where many gave their lives. To have commanded the Constitution is a signal honor. To have been one of her crew, in no matter how humble a capacity, is an equal one. Her name is an inspiration. Not only do her deeds belong to our naval record, but she herself is possessed of a brave personality. In light weathers, in storm or hurricane, or amid the smoke of battle, she responded with alacrity and obedience and seemed ever eager to answer the will of her commander. May the citizens of this country in gratitude see that she, like her namesake and prototype, will never be forgotten. Her commanders in the future, as in the past, will see to it that her flag never shall be lowered. She was conceived in patriotism. Gloriously has she shown her valor. Let her depart in glory if the fates so decree, but let her not sink and decay into oblivion. I'd like to just point out and just camp out on this slide for a second. This is a gouache, I think that's how you pronounce it. I'm not an artist. Painting of the ship in 1803 by a renowned naval artist. His name was Michel Felice Cornet. And it's the earliest depiction that we know of USS Constitution, and it is historically very, very accurate. You'll notice there's 17 stars on the flag. I would also draw your attention to the way the shadows are cast on the sails. And just remember that, because I'll come back to that in a little bit. But this was when she was Commodore Edward Preble's flagship, and she was probably en route to the Mediterranean at this time to do great things for our nation. There can be little doubt that Old Ironsides is an American icon. The images flashing on the screen in front of you are just a small sampling of Old Ironsides memorabilia, postage stamps, movies, clocks, scrimshaw, tobacco tins, the National Geographic magazine, John Philip Sousa, and items from her 1930s national tour, which I'll talk about. But it's not all boring stuff. Probably appropriately to the blue jackets who served in her ship. Yes, there is a bar. It's the Old Ironsides Grill. This is a photograph taken outside Sacramento, California. I'd just like to point out that she is not a museum ship. She is not a museum ship. She is a commissioned warship. Not on active service, but still a commissioned warship. So tonight what I'm going to talk about, I'm not an historian too, so most of what I'm going to be speaking about are personal observations over many years. And so as I've thought about Constitution over the years, I really sort of think of her having essentially three chapters that are appropriate to tonight's presentation. Now, the first one is how she was created, the legend. The second one is the least favorite of mine, which is aging into decay, and of course, resurrection, which I personally like. I'm only going to skim over some of those just to set the context. I'm really going to focus on the last one because I think that's very important to us here as lovers of history. But first of all, she was born, if you like, on the 21st of October, 1797, in fair Boston Harbor. Her first commanding officer is depicted in the upper left, Samuel Nicholson. It was said that he had the uncanny ability of turning a 44-gun frigate into a 20-gun brig. He was not desperately competent, The first court-martial in the United States Navy was held on a ship. He charged one of his lieutenants with drunkenness. He lost the charge. So the very first court-martial in the Navy, defendant was found innocent, which I find interesting. Unfortunately for Samuel Nicholson, the first fatality on the ship was his son, who died of disease and is buried in Hampton when the ship came down here for port visit. Also, he was rather a large guy, and I guess he was exhausted by the whole ceremony of launching the ship. It actually took 3 goes to get it in the water. That he decided to go off and have dinner. Traditionally, the commanding officer of the ship would be allowed the honor of hoisting the Stars and Stripes over his ship. Well, he didn't do that because he was going to come back after dinner to do that. And there are 2 civilians, a Mr. Bentley and a Mr. Harris, who were a little bit offended by this, and they went ahead and raised the Stars and Stripes. So this is very interesting, and this is a theme that you'll see throughout this presentation, is the triangle between the ship, the Navy, and civilians. And it's very interesting, and partly why I think she's still here. An 18th century, a 19th century captain would probably describe this picture as, "My God, she has a beautiful bottom." Perfectly shaped. It was an exquisite design. It was a ship that had the scantlings, the dimensions, the solidity of a ship of the line, the 74. But it was really, it was carrying about 44 guns. So it was designed to withstand some engagement, but sail very fast. She could get up to about 13 knots, carrying about 42,000 square feet of canvas. It's huge. And British sort of looked down their noses at this because they considered our frigates to be overmasted, oversparred, and a bit sort of foo-foo. You know, this pyramid of sail that our frigates, our 6 original frigates, could put aloft was really pretty striking from contemporary accounts. It has quite a draft. It's 23 feet. That's contrasted against a modern frigate today, which draws about 17 feet. And it weighs a lot. It displaces about 2,000 tons. So this is a big ship. But it was designed to go fast and sort of hit and run. It was designed by a Quaker. I'm going to skip over the whole episode of her engaging the Barbary pirates, the bombardment of Tripoli, Edward Preble, and so on and so forth. It's a very important chapter in the United States Navy. This is where you could argue that a lot of our warfighting ethics or ethos comes from. This was the nursery of the Navy, Preble's boys, Stephen Decatur, Isaac Hull, William Bainbridge, Charles Stewart, James Lawrence. These were all taught, if you like. This is where she really got her reputation that endures today. So what I want to do is just spend a little bit of time on her 3 principal victories during the War of 1812 and skip through some other momentous parts of her history before we come up to the last chapter. I put this up because there's a sort of urban myth that has been going around in emails, certainly before the internet was born in the 1970s, but more recently, that she sailed from Boston Harbor in 1799 with 50,000 gallons of water and 50,000 gallons of rum, went and captured France, went to Scotland, captured a distillery, and at the end of her war cruise came back with 50,000 gallons of water and no gallons of rum. And by pure serendipity, someone forwarded me this email. They had no idea I was giving this presentation. I got that email last night. I went, oh, wow, this is incredible. It's the same stuff. But here is, from her official records, what she carried on her war cruises, about 50,000 gallons of water. Why so much water? Because that's what she had to, they used that to steep the salt out of the salt pork. And rum was about 5,000 gallons. Paul Hamilton was the Secretary of the Navy at the outbreak of the War of 1812. And he was an alcoholic. He didn't survive much beyond his tenure in 1812. Isaac Hull was then commanding officer of Constitution when the war broke out. And those of you who may have read or seen Patrick O'Brien's movie Master and Commander, I'm sorry, the movie Master and Commander, which is an amalgamation of two novels. If you remember at the beginning there, it talks in you know, you're directed to go forward and do great things for Great Britain and capture the Acheron. You know, it's sort of, that's the war orders. And everyone goes, wow, that's pretty cool, you know, just a sort of a one-liner. Well, the actual war orders that Paul Hamilton sent are almost as short, and I'll just read it just very quickly. And this is what he sent to Isaac Hull on the eve of when the war was declared. You are, with the force under your command, entitled to every belligerent right to attack, rules of engagement, and capture and defend. You will use the utmost dispatch to reach New York after you've made up your complement of men at Annapolis. That's where she was moored at the time. You are not to understand me as impelling you to battle previously to your having confidence in your crew unless attacked or with a reasonable prospect of success of which you are to be at your discretion to judge. What beautiful orders. In other words, you can attack. If you don't want to attack, that's okay with me. That's not how the Royal Navy thought. Why? Because Paul Hamilton at the time was very worried, since we only had about 17, 18 ships in the United States Navy, as opposed to almost 1,000 ships in the Royal Navy, that the Royal Navy would come in and crush the US Navy and destroy it. So he was very interested in protecting the US Navy. He actually sent two letters, one to Stephen Decatur, one to John Rogers, about 2 weeks before the War of 1812 started, and said, what should I do? And the response back from John Rogers and Stephen Decatur were masterful, almost like they went to a war college. I mean, it's a beautiful assessment of the situation. Rogers had one way of looking at it. Decatur had another way of looking at it, but they're very aggressive. Again, Preble's boys. They were born, they were trained to fight. But Hamilton was very nervous, and he was scared that the US Navy would lose. I sort of call this the first America's Cup. This was a race the United States Navy won. Isaac Hull was looking for John Rogers' squadron. On the 17th of July, he came across a squadron of ships. He gave the private signal. It was a bit confused, and he sailed on further, and then the wind died. And it turned out that he was actually rendezvousing with a Royal Navy squadron. So he went, uh-oh, turned around, and then the great chase started. The ship was at general quarters for about 60 hours. The crew rowed. The crew kedged, which is taking anchors out and heaving around on the capstan to pull ahead. Isaac Hull moved 24 pounders back aft to shoot at the Brits chasing him. The Commodore of the British squadron was probably the finest Royal Navy fighting captain at the time. His name was Vere Brooke, and he was on HMS Shannon. Also present was HMS Guerriere. So after about 60 hours, Isaac Hull, as you can see, crowded on all sail, 42,000 square feet of canvas. They wet the canvas, and he was a superb sailor. He really knew how to sail a ship. Gust of wind came up, he snatched the small boats as the ship was making way, which is another interesting feat of seamanship, and escaped. So that was on the 19th of July, and he went, wow, that was a close call. 1 month later, he's about 400 nautical miles off Halifax, and he sees a sail. So he directs his marine drummer to beat to quarters, and sure enough, there is HMS Guerriere. The next, this painting and the next three paintings are again by Michel Felice Cornet, commissioned by Isaac Hull to document what his victory looked like. And you could say whether it was accurate or not, but these are commissioned by Isaac Hull. This is how he interpreted the battle. Just a couple of points on these paintings. Again, they're very accurate. If you look at the Royal Navy ship, HMS Guerriere, you'll see that her main topsail is aback. This is sort of the language of the year for bring it on. Bring it on, I'm ready to do combat with you. It also stops the ship. Isaac Hull has the weather gauge, which means that he is upwind of the ship, of his enemy. They're taking in the Tagants. That's how you pronounce topgallant, Tagants. And if you look way up there, they're actually striking down one of the royal yards to take down as much top hamper so that relieve the pressure on the masts, so you would avoid having the mast crash down or stuff from aloft coming down and killing sailors on deck. So they're getting the ship ready. They're getting ready to set fighting sail. At about 25 to 50 yards, after the Royal Navy's been shooting at the Constitution for a while, the crew is getting antsy, and Isaac Hull is saying, wait, 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 and then he gives the orders to fire. And the broadside is devastating. These are 24-pound cannonballs, about a half ton of iron being thrown at one time against HMS Guerriere. Such was the excitement. And Isaac Hull was a rather short, squat individual. And in the period dress, his breeches were rather tight. And so when he jumped up on a arms chest to get a better view over the railing, he split his breeches, as it were, all the way up. So he was fighting, you know, letting it all hang out at this point, and motivating his men, and they were encouraged to fight even harder. The masts start to fall on Guerriere. This is where the first Marine Corps officer was killed in combat for the United States. His name was First Lieutenant William S. Bush. He commanded the U.S. Marines on the Constitution, a group of about 50 of them. They were worried that the Royal Marines in Guerriere were going to board Constitution using the jibboom on Guerriere, which was tangled up in the after part of Constitution. So he turned to Isaac Hull and said, "Shall I board her, sir?" And he was shot through the head and died. So he's the first Marine officer killed in combat for the United States of America on board a ship defending the Constitution. So finally, it's 6:30 p.m. This is about 25 minutes of engagement. The last of the masts come down, and as a signal of surrender, because obviously they have no flags to haul down, a single gun is fired to leeward, which means I've surrendered. In the course of the battle, iron cannonballs were bouncing off Constitution's thick hull, and one of the crew members apparently said, "Look, boys, huzzah, her sides are made of iron," and her nickname was created at that point. Just a couple of points on this. Isaac Hull wrote later on African-American sailors who formed part of his crew. He said this, "I never had any better fighters. They stripped to the waist and fought like devils, sir, seeming to be utterly insensible to danger and to be possessed with a determination to outfight their white sailors." So a lot of people don't know that African-Americans served in the United States Navy. Recently, 2 years ago, I visited Dartmoor Prison in the United Kingdom, and this is where War of 1812 prisoners were held. During the War of 1812, there were about 20,000 American POWs. About 6,000 of those were at Dartmoor Prison, which still functions as a prison, and out of those, about 20% were African American. And that is an interesting story. And still to this day, there is a cemetery inside the perimeter of Dartmoor Prison where about 250 American sailors and POWs remain buried. I'd have to say the U.S. Daughters of War of 1812 have put up a monument there so they will not be forgotten. And that's true. There's a change of command. The new commanding officer is William Bainbridge, pictured. And this is on the 29th of December that same year, off the coast of Brazil, sailing in company with USS Hornet, commanded by James Lawrence. He comes across HMS Java, captures it in a little bit longer than 25 minutes. Bainbridge is wounded in the thigh, and the ship's wheel is shot up, so they go on board the Java and take the Java's wheel and put it on Constitution. Both Java and Guerriere are destroyed, so they weren't taken as prizes, they were sunk. Just a little point about the uniform of the officers. This is towards the middle of this is an 1812 uniform, and if you look at it, it's a little bit different from the earlier era, you know, breeches and shoes, which are really more formal. But here you see pantaloons, you see the jacket with the 9 buttons, the 2 epaulets denoting a post captain, and a lieutenant would wear an epaulet on the left shoulder. A master commandant would wear an epaulet on the right shoulder. So that was kind of the uniform they wore. And if you look at uniforms today, you can sort of see similarities with the exception of that hideous Navy working uniform, which is the blue camouflage. I'm not sure what he'd think about it. Just as a little sidebar, because now we're on a roll, but in June of 1813, Verbrugge, the guy in the upper left, this is the guy who is probably one of the finest captains in the Royal Navy, challenges James Lawrence, this impetuous fighting captain. He was had just come from command of the Hornet, a hero, second only to Decatur, supremely self-confident, had just taken command of the Chesapeake, our ship from Norfolk and Portsmouth, which was then up in Boston. He challenged Chesapeake to a single ship duel. He sent his squadron away and said, you know, bring it on, let's do it one-on-one. And Lawrence couldn't, you know, he had to do that. So he went out there, and in about 15 minutes, Chesapeake was captured, and of course, James Lawrence died, don't give up the ship, and a legend was born. I only mention this because the battle ensign from the Chesapeake has not been in this country since 1813. It is currently at the National Maritime Museum in the United Kingdom. Wouldn't it be something? And the Brits are okay with this for a certain amount of money, it's not a lot, to loan that battle flag to one of our museums here in Norfolk, perhaps in 2015. Let's think about that one. The last of the great victories of the War of 1812 actually took place about 2 to 3 days after the Treaty of Ghent was actually finally ratified by the US Congress. So the Battle of New Orleans was not the last battle. I would say this is one of the last battles. I think the very last one was actually fought by the Hornet. But this is probably the greatest sea engagement of the War of 1812 in the Atlantic. So Charles Stewart at the time, pictured in the upper right, was then commanding officer. And he went out and took on two Royal Navy ships at the same time. What's depicted in this painting is he did something that's actually pretty extraordinary. He is backing his main topsail. So he's actually backing the ship. So he's engaged this ship and he's backing down so he can engage Cyane, or Cyane, I think as it was pronounced. So he captured both ships. It's pretty remarkable. Charles Stewart served the United States Navy for 63 years. He was one of the first officers to be promoted to the rank, the new rank of admiral, or rear admiral, which was created in about 1862, I think. He was not lucky in love. His wife, Delia, was a Boston Belle, but she was a spendthrift. She went through his money like nobody's business, and so he was not very lucky there. His grandson was the great Irish patriot, Charles Stewart Parnell. So there you go. It's a very influential individual. So that concludes the War of 1812. The National Intelligencer, which is sort of a newspaper at the time like the Washington Post or the New York Times, noted in 1815 that the Constitution had become the nation's ship. So this idea about her becoming something special started to germinate as early as 1815. Also, at that point, four of her commanding officers had been awarded gold congressional medals. No other ship in the United States Navy has this. So from 1815 to 1830, what happened? Well, she was sent off to the Mediterranean in 1823. This painting is in 1823. The commanding officer at the time was a guy called Jacob Jones. And just to prove that the bright idea ferry, which operates in every service department, was alive and well in the 1820s. And there was this civilian who decided to come up with an idea about temporary paddle wheels that could be sort of mounted through the gun ports, and then using the men to heave around on some endless loop of line, the paddle wheels would turn. And so the idea was that, you know, the ship would rig this and sort of paddle its way out of the harbor until it could set sail. And you can imagine that the commanding officers would look at this and go, well, what are you talking about here? So I think they actually, he probably did it a couple of times. The ship sailed, and I think he left the paddle wheel behind in storage. So now we come to another interesting part, which actually has a local connection. There was a lot going on in the Mediterranean in the 1820s. Not the least was the Ottomans and the Greeks going at each other. And in this particular case, the Greek island of Saros was invaded by the Turks, the Ottomans, and there was this huge massacre. There was a young 6-year-old boy who was pushed out to sea by his mother, who was cut down on the beach. And he drifted out to sea and was picked up by the United States Navy. He was adopted and then enlisted in the Navy. And the painting on the left is this guy, George Sirion, which is a play on Saros. And he's about 10 years old there. He served in the Constitution on three separate occasions, had a long career in the United States Navy. He's settled in Portsmouth. One of his tours was as a gunner supervising the magazine at Craney Island. And he's buried in, I think it's the Cedar Oak or Oak Grove Cemetery in Portsmouth. Interestingly, his great-grandson is a retired Navy captain and lives here as Captain Tom Forbes. By 1830, of course, the ship's pretty old. You have to remember that wooden hull ships back then weren't expected to last more than about 15, 20 years. So it's getting on up there, and the Secretary of the Navy wanted to have ships like the Congress and the Constitution surveyed. Well, guess what? The press got hold of that, just like the press today, and sort of misinterpreted, either intentionally or unintentionally, that the Navy was out to decommission and cut up the ship. And so this generated another firestorm. And so there was this individual called Oliver Wendell Holmes, who was in Boston. And so one evening, he wrote a poem called Old Ironsides, and it's only 143 words, and it starts, I tear her tattered ensign down, long has it waved on high, and many an eye has danced to see that banner in the sky. And it captured the nation. And in fact, as late as the middle of the 20th century, this was taught to school kids. Well, this generated a firestorm, and the Secretary of the Navy said, okay, well, whatever, and they found money to restore it. So, we're now going into the second phase of her life. She's a mature woman, I should say, at this point, aging gracefully. I think this is probably the finest title of a captain. I mean, it's just this Mad Jack Percival, and what a character. I mean, just look at him. For those of you who are Patrick O'Brien fans, he's actually the U.S. equivalent, I think, of Jack Aubrey. He was raised before the mast. He was impressed by the Royal Navy and served in HMS Victory before he escaped, which I think is interesting. He ended up being commanding officer from 1843 to 1846, and then took the ship on a round-the-world cruise, which is pretty remarkable for that time, including, you know, going around Cape Horn and Cape of Good Hope. Went to Vietnam, which we would call today Vietnam, and one of the crew members is buried in Da Nang, and he was, I think, a musician. So that was Mad Jack Percival. For Catholics present, the first time a pope set foot on American territory was on Old Ironsides in 1849. That's Pope Pius IX. You can see him being piped aboard, 21-gun salute fired, crews manning the yards. It's a mark of respect, and he gave mass to, I think, about 80 sailors on board the ship. What's not known probably so widely amongst the public is that the U.S. Navy actually had an anti-slave trade patrol, and this was running for about 40 years, sometimes to effect, sometimes not to effect. This is separate from the institution of slavery in America, but this is the slave trade. The very last prize taken by Constitution was the slave ship Gambrel, which is depicted in the upper right picture, and that was in 1853. And I think that's kind of appropriate. And the commanding officer was a gentleman called Commander Rudd. This is the earliest picture of the Constitution, earliest known picture of the Constitution. She's brought up on the ways in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, being prepped for her next transition to a school ship. This is obviously 1858. But you can see that actually it's quite a large ship below the waterline. So next phase is a school ship. George Dewey of Manila, Bay of Manila fame, Admiral of the Fleet. When he was a lieutenant commander, he actually commanded the Constitution, not as a captain, but as an officer in charge. And then during the Civil War, the U.S. Naval Academy was moved up to Newport, Rhode Island. This is the only known photograph of the ship underway under sail. And if you look at the shadows on the sails, what do they remind you of? The very first picture I showed you, which was Michel Phileas Cornet. So this is a photograph, and you can imagine the skill of Cornet, who was able to visualize, capture with a photographic memory, I guess, the details like that. And this is taken off, I think taken from Fort Monroe. So she's towed up to Portsmouth, New Hampshire, and made into a receiving ship. So if you look at the upper structure there, it's really hideous. But this is up in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, where she resided for a number of years. And so the next few pictures depict her there. This is inside, this is the spar deck. John F. Kennedy's grandfather was instrumental in bringing Constitution down from Portsmouth, New Hampshire to Boston to commemorate her centennial in 1897. And if it weren't for him, I'm not sure what would have happened. But the Navy came down and really celebrated her centennial And here's a colorized postcard of the time. This is not my most favorite Secretary of the Navy. He's actually the great nephew of Napoleon Bonaparte, and he was Teddy Roosevelt's Secretary of the Navy. So I guess, you know, sort of one of those bureaucratic things, he thought it'd be really neat if the ship would be, and he recommended to Congress that the ship would be towed out and used by the North Atlantic Fleet, which is U.S. Fleet Force's predecessor, and, you know, used as target practice and sunk at sea. Everything that I've read at the time, this generated a firestorm. He also probably didn't realize that Teddy Roosevelt had written a dissertation when he was at college called The Naval War of 1812. So he didn't last very long. He went on to be the Attorney General. But interestingly, this also spurred another response from a citizen. This was an Armenian American, Moses Haji Galesian, who had emigrated to this country and was so captivated by this whole story that he telegraphed the Secretary of the Navy and said, "Hey, I'll buy the ship from you for $10,000. Now, I don't know if this sparked more outrage from the American public in support of this, but it's just one of those things, and the Armenian American community is actually very proud of Moses Galesian for adding to the Constitution story. Anyway, so to fast forward a little bit, they found money, and here she is restored. You can see the upper structure's taken off, and she's in Boston Navy Yard, 1907. I'm just going to fast forward again to 1927 to 1930. This is the next big overhaul. The Navy was fortunate that the constructor, Jack Lord, had actually been trained in working with wooden hull ships. So he wasn't a metal guy, he was a wood guy. This is what the ship looked like when it was brought into dry dock number one up in the Charlestown Navy Yard. And then there down at the lower left is a picture of her entering San Francisco Harbor in the 1930s. She was recommissioned in 1931, and there was a desire to take her on a tour around the nation to pay back, if you like, the $1 million or so that was spent on restoring her. So she was taken on this tour, and she visited 76 ports in 35 months. And this is actually the last time that a serving president of the United States has set foot on the ship, which is Hoover. Still remains true today. She was towed 22,000 miles, visited 21 states, and went to Cuba and Panama. And if you look at in front of the ship, that is the Navy tug Grebe, and she was her buddy, towing her all over the place. The commanding officer at the time was a guy called Commander Gulliver. In the 35 months, there were 4.6 million visitors to the ship, and this is back in the 30s, so it's a pretty significant percentage of America. This is still an unbroken record. Closer to home, here's a picture of her coming into Norfolk. At the time, the population of Norfolk, the census figures for 1930 reflect Norfolk's population is about 129,000. So when you look at 85,000 visitors to the ship in Norfolk, that's pretty significant over a 1 week period. So here she is tied up at the old India Wharf. And the best that I can figure out, the India Wharf is sort of between where to the east of the Berkeley Bridge and a little bit to the west of Harbor Park. Of course, that building is no longer there. So there's Commander Gulliver, and on the right is Norfolk Mayor Jeff Robertson presenting a bouquet of flowers. On the left here is the city attorney, John Sebrell. And so I was trying to figure out why they're smiling and why the sailor's smiling. Well, this is 1931. Prohibition was still the law. So there's a picture of the crew, and you can see there are Marines and sailors. When I commanded the ship, I actually spoke with one of the Marines, and he described how he met his wife. They were still married, and she had walked on board the ship during the tour and saw this young Marine she thought was pretty good looking and decided to get married, and that was that. So something good came out of that tour. I'm going to fast forward a little bit here to 1954, and President Eisenhower signed this into law, and we have parsed this to death. What exactly, for example, thereafter to maintain the United States ship Constitution at Boston, does maintain mean maintain as in repair or maintain as in location? And believe me, the lawyers looked at all that on a separate issue. But so that's basically what the law says. It tells the Navy to restore her, but not for active service. Queen Elizabeth II, and on the right is Commander Ty Martin. I was speaking to him last night about this, and just said, hey, do you have any, you know, vignettes or anecdotes about the Queen's visit? You know, it's kind of a sort of neat thing. And he said, yeah, well, I could probably tell you something. He said, the only people allowed on the ship were the Queen, Sec-Nav Bittendorf, who's the guy in the middle, and Prince Philip is the shorter individual behind Secretary of the Navy, and Ty Martin. So he was showing the Queen around, and she was pretty noncommittal, and he said he wasn't really sort of, he was speaking a little bit louder, he was speaking sort of more English, he was, you know, she was just being very polite. So he took her down below decks, down to the gun deck, and was showing her around, and then at some point she noticed that one of the guns had a cipher on it, which said, you know, George III. So she turned to her husband, Prince Philip, to say, Philip, we need to talk to the secretary about transferring of munitions to foreign nationals or something like that. So it's a queenly thing to say. The next big overhaul, this is actually very, very significant structurally, was the 92 to 95 overhaul. And this is sort of a little difficult to explain, but up until this point, for about 100 years, these diagonal riders, which you can see going down at a diagonal, that's why they're called diagonal riders, or like ribs, were absent. And so what this meant was that the hog of the ship, which is the forces pushing down at the bow here and the stern, created a hog. The ship was literally bending in the middle. And when she went into overhaul, that hog was about 2 feet, which is pretty significant. So when they reinstall these diagonal riders, what happens is the weight of the ship is, instead of going vertically down, it's actually transferred fore and aft to a middle point. And it's a design that that Joshua Humphreys had, and it predated the Royal Navy's sepping system. So it was actually kind of innovative. This is what gives her the great strength. Okay, the historic sail. About 3 weeks before the sail, and when I knew that I was going to command the Constitution, the commanding officer at the time was Commander Mike Beck. And he called me up and said, hey, would you like to come up and help me out? I need all the hands I can get. And I said, absolutely. I said, I'd like you to be my officer of the deck. I said, I can do that, you know, surface warfare kind of guy. And so I had the great privilege of being on board when he set sail. So there you are. This was a sight at the time that no one alive had seen, which is an 18th century warship under sail. USS Halliburton is the ship in the middle. It's a frigate. And the Ramage is the Arleigh Burke destroyer on the right. Out of the three ships there, there's only one ship that's actually seen combat against an enemy combatant. That's the ship on the left. In today's Navy, there are only two ships in commission that have engaged enemy combatants, and one of them is on the left. And my favorite ship, my favorite picture of the ship, and I think just sort of an ironic thing that here's the Secretary of the Navy, Secretary Dalton behind the wheel, and sailing the ship as she's making, you know, 5 knots through the water. And it was just a glorious day. It was absolutely fantastic. I point out this thing about this thread of citizens and history and being engaged. While sometime during dinner, the Master Chief Petty Officer of the Navy came out and asked me to step outside because there was a young person who wanted to see me. So there I am. Whoops. There I am. And here's this individual. His name is Tripp. And there's his mother. And so he's 9 years old at the time, and in his hand is a coffee can filled with pennies. And his father had died 4 years before, and he was a Cub Scout, and he went around collecting pennies for Old Ironsides. So I collected those pennies and turned it over to the chairman. So he had faith in the ship. And exactly 10 years later to the day, we arranged to meet exactly the same place, and he was 19 years old, going to Brown University, and doing really very well for himself. A really decent American. A few months after that is the actual anniversary, the bicentennial of the ship's launching. And sort of ironic, but the only message of congratulation we received was from the Royal Navy, from the commanding officer of HMS Victory, and you can read what he sent to me. But with nothing from the United States Navy in any shape or form, which is sort of interesting. 21 October is a momentous day because that's also Trafalgar Day, and that's when Nelson was shot down on Victory in 1805. So there was a second historic sail, which is the bicentennial of when she captured the Guerriere, and I was on board for that as well, and that was very, very neat. And then something that I've been working on for about 13 years was to get the Congress to formally designate Constitution as America's ship of state. And President Obama signed that into law in 2009, in the 2010 National Defense Authorization Act. So she has two acts, one in 1954 and then the one in 2009. And this one's very important. So she is now America's ship of state. The Navy is, again, fully engaged. This is half of the crew in their period uniform, which is not a costume. It's actually codified. It's only half the crew. I'd also mention that it does not represent the civilian riggers. These are Navy civilians who work the wood, make the rope, make the sails, and they are our professional riggers, and they're just an awesome bunch of individuals. So some observations. And I think this applies to a lot of what we do here in the Norfolk Historical Society, but apathy is the enemy of history and heritage. If you don't do anything about it, don't expect government to step in. It's just not gonna work. Citizens can and do make a difference. Doesn't matter how young you are or how old you are, they make a difference. And in this ship, I've just glossed over 216 years of a history, but I think that you'll see that there's a pattern there. And finally, don't mess with Old Ironsides.